Hi, hello, and welcome to the last webinar of this series SBBC ISSCR. We want to thank ISSCR for this partnership. We had three very exciting talks, and we are going to have our last one in a few moments. And I would like to give a special thank to Jack Mosher from ISSCR for helping us to putting these webinars together. We had really incredible talks. So before I introduce today's speaker, I'd like to remind you that the SBBC Congress this year will be 100% online. You're going to see in a few moments. Oh, this is from ISSCR, our partner. And then, Irene, if you could please put the next slide on. Yeah, so just a reminder that our Congress is going to be 100% online, and it's going to be in January from 27 to 29 in 2021. And the registration is open. So now it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker for today, Professor Nicolas Vivron, who I thank very much for being here with us today. It's an honor to have you. So Dr. Vivron graduated from Université de Technologie de Compiègne in France. He graduated in physics and engineering, and then he got his PhD in the Netherlands, working with vascular biology and tissue engineering. And presently, he's a group leader at the Institute of Molecular Biotechnology in the Austrian Academy of Science, working on synthetic mammalian development. So, Nicolas, thank you very much for accepting our invitation.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for inviting me. Thank you so much for making this event happen, and I'm extremely happy to be talking today in front of an audience that that we value a lot, and that also in such a place that I would have loved to come by today, but you know, like nowadays things are not happening as it should. So I will talk today about our work that we are doing in using stem cells in order to understand the early events of mammalian development. And we developed a model of the conceptus only formed by stem cells, which we called the blastoid. And I will like to first explain a little bit the scientific findings that that unfolded in the last decade. As we all know, the fetus is growing fueled by the extraminic tissues, extraminic organs such as the placenta, and the placenta is very well known to nurture and feed the fetal development. However, what we and others highlighted is that in the very early stage, at the blastocyst stage, which is before implantation inside the uterus, when the structure is only 100 micrometers and about 100 cells, it is actually the opposite. It is the embryonic cells that are fueling, that are feeding the future placenta, which are the green cells that you see here. So at this very early stage of development, the embryonic cells are spending a lot of energy to nurture those cells that you can see here in order for them to develop and later form the placenta. And the placenta gives it back later by feeding the fetus. So in some way, in those very early stages, the embryo is spending energy and time to invest on its own future by inducing the development of those cells. And it does so because the placenta will form and later help it to develop. It also does so because those cells are playing a very important intermediate function, which is to mediate the implantation inside the uterus. So it is those cells here that are mediating the attachment to the uterus, which is absolutely essential for mammalians. So I'll start by giving a very brief summary of early embryonic development. As you all know, it all starts with the fertilization of an egg by a sperm, which leads to the formation of a genetically unique cell. And this genetically unique cell is going to divide to form 2 cells, 4 cells, 8 cells. And within this time lap, the cells are thought to be very similar one to another. The cells do not belong to a specific lineages. And but what happens is that when the embryo progresses from about 8 cells to 16 cells, it forms what we call a morula. And within this morula, there's a very clear lineage segregation that occurs, where the first cell types are formed. And those cell types are on the outer, those green cells that are called the trophoblasts. And the trophoblasts are going to form the whole placenta. And inside, you can see those red cells here that are called the inner cell mass, and that are going to form then the full embryo. And this inner cell mass is also generating a third cell type, which has those white cells here that are called the primitive endoderm. So this is our structure of interest. This is a conceptus just before it implants inside the uterus. And it contains a monolayer of trophoblast cells that surround a fluid-filled cavity and a cluster of embryonic cells and those primitive endoderm cells. The primitive endoderm cells are an other extra-embryonic tissue that is going to form the yolk sac. And this blastocyst is going to progress to this stage. And at this point, the whole structure is ready to implant inside the uterus. And instead of this, what we can do is to harvest those blastocysts and to put them in culture. And depending on the medium that we use, we can expand the stem cells that it contains. If we use a leukemia inhibitory factor, LIF, we can expand the embryonic stem cells. And if we use FGF4, fibroblast growth factor 4, we can expand trophoblast stem cells. And these are stem cell lines that can be massively expanded in a culture dish. Okay, let's start this again. And those stem cells, they are frozen in time. They do not progress in development. They remain blastocyst-like. And the best way that we can show this is that we can, after weeks or months of culture, we can still inject them into a mouse blastocyst, and they are going to contribute to their respective embryonic or placental development. So what we did in the lab is to combine those 2 stem cell types in a dish and to find conditions under which they spontaneously organize into structures that are remarkably similar to the blastocyst and that we called blastoids. And of course, because we form blastoids with stem cells, we have some very important advantages that we can generate a very large number of those structures, and we can also tune them in very precise ways. These are so here I would like to very briefly emphasize the reason why we are doing those experiments. there is an enormous scarcity of embryos, especially human IVF embryos for research. And this makes it impossible to perform all the experiments, for example, the genetic and the drug screens that lie at the heart of scientific and biomedical discoveries. I'm talking here about human IVF embryos. Today, I will only talk about mouse, but it is the same for mouse. Mouse embryos are also a little bit less difficult to harvest, but they also come in very small numbers. So by forming blastoids, we can suddenly generate very large numbers of those structures, and we can do very complex gene editing, especially of subpopulations. So this opens up for the first time to the possibility of running high-throughput genetic and drug screen on such structures, which of course is the basic for scientific and biomedical discoveries. So these are blastoids in real life. You can see that they are very, very nicely formed in a quite regular way, and that they are nicely aligned, and I will show you why they are aligned. We published this paper in 2018. That was the first time that a model of the full conceptus was formed from stem cells. And since then, last year, there were like three labs that repeated our study and showing very similar results. In order to form those blastoids, we use microwell arrays. So these are microfabricated mini wells that allow us to pull the stem cells in very specific numbers and ratios. And pulling those stem cells in very specific numbers and ratio is absolutely essential to form blastoids. You must have a very specific number of embryonic stem cells plus very specific number of trophoblast stem cells. Once you have pulled those numbers, we discovered what are the minimal factors that are necessary for those stem cells to remember where they come from and to stimulate them to self-organize into those blastoid structures. And once I'm very happy to talk about what are the function of those molecules that I just showed you, I will pass briefly through it for sake of time. But once those blastoids have formed, they actually contain analogs of the three cell types that are forming the blastocyst and that later develop into the full organism. They contain those NANOG and OCT4 positive epiblast cells, the embryonic cells that are going to form the full body, those trophoblasts that are expressing a key transcription factor, CDX2, and the niche is also permissive for the emergence of a third cell type, which is the primitive endoderm cells. And those primitive endoderm cells that I showed you in the movie are actually coming by arising by differentiation from those embryonic cells. So the embryonic cells, some embryonic cells differentiate to form those primitive endoderm cells. The blastoids are morphologically very similar to a blastocyst, and they form very rapidly, actually in the time frame that is very similar to the formation of a blastocyst. Within 48 hours, we have a structure like this, with this fluid-filled cavity, the cluster of embryonic cells, and the cyst of trophoblast. Here, I told you about the efficiency, about the number. The formation of blastoid is efficient, but it is efficient only with a specific number and ratios of stem cells. When 8 embryonic stem cells and 20 trophoblast stem cells are pooled, we have about 70% of the microwells that form a blastoid. However, when we shift away from those absolute or relative numbers, you can see that the percentage of microwells that include the blastoid are very strongly decreasing. So there is clearly a synergy between the cell type and a very specific interaction that happens between the two to form blastoids. So at this point, the most difficult, the most stringent assay that we can apply to test those blastoids is to place them back into the uterus of a mouse. And this is what we did here. And the blastoids are about this size. You can see the red dot here. And you can see that they are very nicely implanting. And as a reaction, the uterus is forming this cocoon that is called a decidua. Very similarly to what's happening during blastocyst implantation. And those cocoons are very nicely irrigated by blood vessels, which is a normal process at the time of implantation. And if we cut open those cocoons, we can find back the blastoids. And we observe that those blastoids are proliferating. They are differentiating. We find many cell types. For example, we find those proliferin positive trophoblasts that are on the side of the embryo and that are hooking up with the blood vessels of the mother in order to form those chimeric blood vessels that are going to irrigate the site of implantation. So there are some very interesting aspects happening here. However, similar to all embryo models at the moment, blastoids do not develop for a long time. And within 2 days, they become very disorganized. So there are clearly some elements, some small parameters that are missing for those blastoids to fully form an embryo and a mouse, ultimately. So the approach is quite different from classical embryology in the sense that we are building, reconstituting those blastocysts like structures from the bottom up, and we are looking for those minimal features that would allow specific morphogenetic and developmental processes to happen. So this is a totally new approach to embryology, and we are very excited about trying to understand what are those minimal features that are necessary. So I told you in this first part that blastoids are modeling some aspects of blastocyst development. I showed you that based on the specificity of the cell numbers, we speculate that there is an important communication that's happening between the two cell types that probably drives the development of the structure. And finally, that blastoids are recapitulating some aspects of implantation inside the uterus. So in this second part, I would like to switch gear a little bit and go into the mechanistic aspects of how the structures form and what they can teach us about the development of the conceptus and in that case the mouse blastocyst. And so the second part will be about trying to use this model in order to understand the cooperative behavior that happened between the embryonic and the extra-embryonic tissues. So first, I would like to explain what is known about those interactions. So it has been quite well assessed via microdissection and some knockout studies that there are some very important factors that are secreted by the embryonic cells and that regulate the proliferation of the trophoblast. This was first done in 1978 and even a little bit before. So 1978 it was Cope, and in 1974, if I'm right, it was Richard Gardner. And they did this by just counting the number of cells, the number of mitotic events, and by doing micro dissection by, for example, cutting the blastocyst into pieces and trying to see how the cells behave. And this led to this idea of those embryonic cells inducing the proliferation of the trophoblast. And it's 20 years later that Janet Ronson, the lab of Janet Ronson, and especially Tanaka here, discovered that indeed there is a very key molecule, FGF4, that is produced by the embryonic cells and regulate the proliferation of the trophoblast. And this is actually the rationale behind Janet Ronson using FGF4 in order to derive and propagate mouse trophoblast stem cells from the blastocyst. And so this is what was known. And now what we did here is to build on this knowledge to better understand those embryonic inductions. And we did this by directly comparing blastoids with trophospheres. And trophospheres are formed exactly in the same way as blastoids, but without the embryonic stem cells. So we formed those trophospheres by seeding them on top of the microwells, culturing them in exactly the same culture conditions as we do for blastoids, but without the embryonic stem cells. And when we do so, you see that the trophoblast form those what we call trophospheres. You can see three of them here, and you can already appreciate that they have like a very different phenotype as compared to the blastoids. They tend to be smaller. And they are definitely smaller, and they are more distorted. And by comparing the two, we can understand what are those embryonic inductions. So the first thing that we did is to verify what was already known in the blastocyst and to see if this was also happening in the blastoid. And so the first thing is the proliferation. And so this is the initial number of trophoblasts that we seed at the beginning. And you see that when the blastoids are formed, this number of trophoblasts tremendously increase. There's more than a threefold increase in number. And on the contrary, what you see in trophospheres, it barely increases. So clearly, the presence of the embryonic cells is inducing the proliferation of the trophoblast here. And we can do the same by looking at the potential for those trophoblasts to form colonies. So we dissociate the blastoids and the trophospheres, and we place single trophoblast into a well, and we wait for a certain number of days, and we look if those cells are capable of forming a colony, so of multiplying as stem cells. This is what is called self-renewal of stem cells. And you can see that the trophoblasts from blastoids have a much higher propensity to form colonies as compared to the trophoblasts of trophospheres. This is a logarithmic scale here. So clearly, the presence of the embryonic cells is promoting maintaining the self-renewal of those trophoblasts, whereas in the case of trophospheres, they rapidly lose this potential to self-renew. So now we can go a little bit more deep into the molecules. And in order to do so, we did a systematic inventory of those embryonic inductions by comparing the trophoblasts from blastoids and trophospheres. And this is a single cell sequencing analysis. And here you have the trophoblast stem cells in 2D. These are the parental cells. These are the trophoblasts that were harvested from the blastoids. And these are the trophoblasts that are coming from trophospheres. And so each single point here represents one cell. And the location of this cell in this XY axis is a proxy for the transcriptome of this single cell. So when you can see that all the trophoblast stem cells in 2D culture and 2D cluster more or less together. However, when we culture them in the blastoids, the transcriptome is shifting, and it's even shifting more when in trophospheres. And so we can now look at all the genes that are regulating between those cells and those cells, and use this as a proxy, an approximation for the importance of those embryonic inductions. And so we came up with a couple of lists. And here I show you just one, which is a list about signaling pathway that are active in the blastoids, but not in the trophospheres. So these are signaling pathways that are activated by the presence of the embryonic cells. And we see that at the top of the list, we see the MAP kinase signaling pathway. This is the FGF the pathway that is activated by FGF. So we are very happy to see this. It makes us confident about our assay. And then we can go down the list and look at all those pathways. We can see a very nice, a lot of developmental pathway, the RAS signaling pathway. Here you can see the HIPPO pathway, FOXO pathway, JAK-STAT, WNT. And we actually stopped on TGF-beta signaling pathway because we observed that in the same data set that the hominic stem cells are very nicely producing nodal and also BMP4 and BMP7. This has been partly reported previously. It was not completely clear, but so we confirmed it in this assay. And we see that the trophoblasts seem to respond to this nodal. And indeed, if we do a single molecule FISH for nodal, so each dot here is an RNA for nodal, and you can see that those the hominic cells, the inner cells, are very nicely expressing nodal, and this is barely expressed or not at all expressed in the outer trophoblast. So this is a very good candidate as a pure hominic inducer, only produced by the hominic cells, and very likely to activate. Based on our data, it's activating some signaling activity in the trophoblast. And now what we can do is to replace the hominic stem cells by those factors and see how the trophospheres are behaving. And we looked at all kinds of parameters. Here I'll show you the diameter of the cystic structure. So this is the average diameter of a blastoid. We can see the trophosphere is much smaller. But when we dose BMP4 or nodal on top of those trophospheres, then you can see that the diameter is increasing. And when you combine them together, you get almost the diameter of a blastoid. So the first thing that we did here is to count the number of cells, thinking, okay, just like FGF4, BMP4 and nodal is probably inducing the proliferation of those trophoblasts. It turns out that this is not the case. We did not see an effect on proliferation. However, the diameter clearly increases. So what we think is that those factors that are produced by the hominic cells are here to induce a swelling of the trophoblast. And in the presence of those factors, the trophoblasts are capable of blowing like a balloon. So what we did to confirm this is to do a nodal knockout only in hominic stem cells, and we measure also the size of the cavity. You can see that as compared to a wild type, when you knock out nodal only in hominic stem cells, then we reduce the size of the cavity and, of course, of the overall diameter. We sequenced those different blastoids, and we noticed that nodal is activating CDX2, which is a transcription factor of the trophoblast that I already told you about, and also KLF6. And we also saw some nice regulation of some adherence and tight junctions. So what we think is happening is that nodal is activating those transcription factors that are regulating those cell-cell junctions in order to tighten the trophoblast. And so we can now do a knockout for KLF6 only in the trophoblast stem cells this time. And what we noticed is we see the same phenotype as with the nodal knockout, but this time by knocking out in the trophoblast. When we knock out KLF6, the size of the cavity reduces. So this is suggesting that there's nodal coming from the hominic cells that is activating the nodal pathway, regulating KLF6, and reducing modulating the swelling of the structure. We can confirm this by those assays here where we stimulated trophospheres. So when we stimulate, I'll show you just this one. Maybe. When we stimulate trophospheres with BMP4 and nodal, the diameter increases. However, when we have a KLF6 knockout trophosphere, the size is a little bit smaller to start with, and they do not respond to BMP4 and nodal. And we can see that the cadherin seems to be very nicely regulated within those wild-type blastoids, whereas they are barely expressed, or a lot less expressed in the trophectoderm or trophoblast of a KLF6 knockout. I will pass this for the sake of time, but what we see also is that those embryonic inductions that are coming from here are nurturing those cells, but that the cells that are on the opposite side are actually more differentiating, and these are the cells that are attaching, that are mediating the attachment to the uterus. So the function of this cavity is actually to separate this pool of trophoblasts from this one, and those ones that are very exposed to those embryonic inductions are maintained as stem cells and are going to form the whole placenta, whereas those ones that are further are going to differentiate to mediate the attachment to the uterus. So what I showed you here is that those embryonic inductions are regulating the proliferation, the self-renewal, and the epithelial morphogenesis of the trophoblast. Or at least this is what the blastoid model is suggesting. On the contrary, when in the absence of those embryonic cells, those trophoblasts are stop proliferating, downregulate self-renewal, and I didn't show you, but they are massively differentiating. They are differentiating into post-implantation cell, trophoblast cell types. So they start to form placental cells. And so the question is, do those structures, are they still capable of implanting inside the uterus? And what we observed is that when we transfer those trophospheres inside the uterus, they have a largely diminished potential to implant inside the uterus. So overall, all those embryonic signals are here to maintain the potential for those trophoblasts to implant inside the uterus. So they have the function of gatekeeping the trophoblast to implant inside the mother. So a very important process, of course, during embryonic development. So these are my last conclusions. We made a systematic inventory of those embryonic inductions. We showed that they maintain the core transcription factors. I didn't show you this data, but it's published. They are preventing the differentiation of the trophoblast, and they are regulating the epithelial morphogenesis, also the proliferation self-renewal, and that all together, those molecular signals, those embryonic inductions, are maintaining the potential to implant inside the uterus. So I'd like to finish by saying that we are not the only one who are making models of the embryo using stem cells. What we developed is what we call the blastoid, which is the model of the pre-implantation embryo. It was the first time that we had the three cell types that form the full organism and a model of the whole conceptus. There's also the lab of Magdalena Zernika-Götz that developed a very nice model of the inner part of the post-implantation embryo. So they did not form the outer part of the conceptus, but they have a very nice model of the inner part. And there's the famous gastruloid model of the of Alfonso Martinez Arias that models the elongation of the tail of the mouse embryo. It starts forming somites. And lately, Alfonso also generated the human version of the gastruloid. And finally, there's also a very nice model by Jiaping Fu, who on the human side that developed an amniotic epiblast model. And so this is an emerging field. It's quite exciting at the moment. And this is also raising some ethical issues or some ethical questions. We are tackling them. We are very interested into those questions. And we already wrote two reports about it. And we are about to produce a third one early next year, actually, with Janet Ronson. So thank you very much. I'd like to thank the people in the lab. So we are the IMBA Institute that is full of people working with stem cells and organoids at the Austrian Academy of Science. It's a wonderful place. This is the team. These are our collaborators at the Hubert Institute, where I used to, people I'm collaborating with a lot with, at the Broad Institute, also at the Riken Institute and Erasmus University. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Nicholas. Oh, it was a great talk. Thank you so much. We have questions from the audience. So the first question is the ideal ICM TF ratio for blastoid formation similar to the ratio in natural blastulas?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so we can actually tune those numbers in order to fall exactly in the number of the blastocyst. So this is just a matter of like seeding the right number of cells at the beginning. What's interesting is now we can also put numbers that are abnormal, and we can put a little bit more embryonic stem cells or a little bit less, and see, for example, how the trophectoderm reacts to this. We can also do the invert. We can do we can add a little bit more or a little bit less trophoblast stem cells and see how this is impacting the embryonic cells, for example, or the primitive endoderm cells. So these are all kind of experiments that are possible now and that allow us to better understand how the blastocyst regulates its own development.
Thank you. Next question. Did you find any candidate for embryonic induction that is present in the three populations of trophoblast in the single cell analysis?
So one factor that would be in the three populations, I'm pretty sure that there are some. We would have to look again into that data. The one that I'm thinking of now are the IL, the interleukins. For example, IL-11. Is clearly expressed in the embryonic cells and also in the trophoblast cells. I think it is also expressed in the primitive endoderm, but I have to check. The function of what we discovered is that the function of IL-11 is to activate the STAT pathway and to regulate the self-renewal of the trophoblast. It might also regulate the self-renewal of the embryonic part, and these are things that we are looking into right now. We focused more on nodal because it is a pure embryonic inducer, so it is much more cleaner assay in order to understand what's happening in this system.
Thank you. Do the two cell types in the blastoids, they sort themselves, or is there a fate conversion depending on their inside-out location? Question from Irene.
I'm not sure if I understand the question right, In our case, we are using trophoblast stem cells and embryonic stem cells that are already committed. So I think the question refers to what's happening in the morula, which is a little bit one day earlier, where cells that are very similar becomes either trophoblast or embryonic. And here there's like really like an inner-outer effect where the outer cells develop apical domains that regulates the Hippo pathway, and this leads to the expression of CDX2 that leads to the trophoblast fate. So this is something very important happening one day earlier. However, with blastoids, we start with already committed trophoblast and embryonic stem cells. So we did not really observe an inner-outer effect here.
Okay. So I have one very naive question. Oh, there's Irene. Do you want to place that question? Then I'll ask mine. Okay. If you supplement the trophospheres with FGF4, do you recover the proliferation rate?
That's a very good question. The answer is not really. So it can boost a little bit the proliferation, but not so much. And this is very interesting because it means that FGF4 is not sufficient in order to induce the proliferation. And what we think is that the way that the cell is presenting FGF4 is extremely important for the trophoblast to respond. And we know, for example, that FGF4 also needs some boosters in order to be taken by the neighbor cells. Some of those boosters, for example, are heparan sulfates. These are very small molecules that are going to like bind to the FGF4 and allow and increase the potency of the molecule to signal into the cell. So here, those this interface that you have here is very important. And there are probably some crucial factors that are secreted here that allow to regulate the trophoblast to incorporate the MAP kinase, the FGF4, and activate the MAP kinase pathway. So we do recapitulate some proliferation, but not all. Which is very interesting. Now we start discovering things that we did not know before. Also,
thank you. So my naive question was is about extracellular matrix. If those cells they produce any extracellular matrix components, proteins or proteoglycans, you mentioned heparan sulfate, but I believe you're talking about transmembrane heparan sulfate proteoglycans, right?
Yeah. So they also secrete extracellular matrix. What we observed is they might be secreting a lot more than this, but what we observe is that they are very clearly expressing laminins, and it's the trophoblast. It's both the trophoblast and the primitive endoderm cells that are producing those laminin molecules. Those in the trophoblast, those laminin molecules are mostly produced by those cells here, which are the cells that are going to mediate the attachment to the uterus. And at the same time, those cells are regulating their integrins. Integrins are alpha-7, for example. And the integrins plus the laminin is probably inducing those cells to change phenotype in order to prepare them to invade inside the uterus. Yeah. So this is for the trophoblast. Laminins are mostly here, and for the primitive endoderm, the primitive endoderm cells are definitely producing laminin at the interface here, in order to induce their own epithelialization. So they produce their own basement membrane in order to generate apical basal polarity, which is very important for functions.
Okay, thank you. There's one more question here. There's any other factor that can induce proliferation of trophoblast cells?
So at the moment, FGF4 is definitely the winner. You know, it is definitely the most important factor. However, for a stem cell to be maintained, you should not only proliferate, but you should also not differentiate. So those trophoblasts that are here, that are very strongly exposed to the embryonic inductions, they incorporate FGF4, but it is clearly not sufficient for them to remain as stem cells and then to form the whole placenta. In order to also remain as stem cells and to self-renew, they must incorporate nodal and also probably IL-11. So this is what we propose. The nodal part was already quite known, because we know that that FGF4 is not sufficient to maintain trophoblast stem cells in culture. You must also have serum, or if you don't have serum, you must have serum-free medium plus TGF-beta or activin. So it was clear that TGF-beta was important for, or TGF-beta ligands were important for self-renewal. And and what we propose is that it is the nodal that is produced here by the embryonic cells that feeds them for self-renewal. And on top of this, we added IL-11, and we showed that IL-11 is actually very important to regulate, for example, the expression of CDX2, which is this key stem cell transcription factor of the trophoblast. So So we think that there are at least like three elements that are necessary for maintaining those stem cells. Yeah.
Thank you. I just learned that we have two more questions and then we will let you go. So is that okay?
Yeah.
Irene, so you can post. Okay. Is the TGF-beta beta pathway regulating expression of the blastocell pump that mediates fluid inflow?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So in order to like form an epithelial cyst, you must seal the cells so that they don't leak. And once you have sealed them, then you can pump ions, which induce differences of osmotic pressure, which induce an inflow of water molecules. Yeah. So those pumps that are necessary to form the cavity, the fluid, to pump the fluid into the cavity, are either aquaporins or sodium potassium pumps. And we did not see that nodules or TGF-beta ligands are regulating neither aquaporins or sodium potassium pumps. Let me rephrase it, it did not pop up in our sequencing data set. It does not mean that it's not regulated, but we would have to like study this a lot more in detail, and maybe it is only regulated at the beginning, and we looked at more late time point where things are already stabilized. So we cannot exclude your hypothesis indeed that TGF-beta is also regulating the pumps. However, we did not see it. What we saw is more of the adherence junction, so we focused on the sealing mechanism. But yeah, those experiments should be done. You know, like there are chances that this could very well be happening also.
Thank you. Does that so the question is that mean that in the absence of nodule, the blastocell fluid is leaking out?
So this is again a very good question. We do not know at the moment. That would be extremely interesting. So we let's be clear. We are presenting a model that represents our current knowledge or our current interpretation of our data, and I think this there's a lot more work that needs to be done in order to like fully understand what would be interesting first is to check if our tropospheres are more leaky than blastoids, and this I guess we could do this by looking at diffusions of dyes through the membranes, through the epithelium. So this should be possible. Even more interesting, it would be nice to go back to the blastocyst and to induce a knockout of nodal only in the embryonic cells. Nodal might be important a little bit before, so there would be like some genetic fine-tuned genetic modifications to be done here, but the question, it would be interesting to see if in these knockouts the trophectoderm becomes more leaky, and here the experiment needs to be done. Interesting.
Okay, so thank you very much. I think we have no more questions. And so once again, I would like to thank you for accepting this invitation. And I hope we can bring you here in person someday when all this madness ends.
Thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you so much for the questions. It was very interesting. And I wish you a very good day.
Thank you. You too. Bye.
Bye.